By feelings, I won't fast to what is true. cross brings transformation. And I'll be crucified with you. Cause death is just the door. Father in heaven, you are holy, holy, holy. Even right now, angels around your throne are singing, are bowing before you. All of creation testifies to your greatness and your glory. There is none like you. You're perfect in your power. You're blazing in purity. No one can stand before you. Father, it is a miracle of mercy this morning that we can draw near to you. And in fact, Lord, that is your very invitation to us, to draw near. We who are stained with our sin, who have rebellious hearts. And so, Lord, we come not through any confidence that we have in ourselves and our abilities and what we have done, but we come only and ever through Jesus, our sinless Savior who came down to this earth to bear our punishment. Wear our sin, that we might be righteous. That our praises to you this morning, you hear and are pleased because Jesus perfects our praises. We now get to do what we were created to do, which is give you glory. And so we exalt you, God. We exalt you in your power, your holiness. We exalt you in your mercy and your grace. Spirit of God, fill our hearts with belief. That you are God. And you have saved your people. Lord, now as we come to your word, give us hearts that are ready to receive, ready to respond, Give us hearts that are wanting to follow you, wanting to honor you, wanting to glorify you. Spirit, give us the strength that we don't have on our own. Speak to us. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. We worship you in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Well, it's so good to worship with you, to gather with you. If you're here last week, we began a two-part series talking about evangelism and this idea that we as Christians are called to share our faith, to be ambassadors, to represent Jesus to the world. And we've got a lot of resources for you in this regard. Before we get into our text today, we're going to be in Colossians 4, if you want to go ahead and start turning. But I just want to draw a couple of resources to your attention. The first thing, it's in your bulletin, and I think that this is a super helpful resource. We talked about it last week. The top part of this card is basically just a short synopsis of something that we call Table Talk, where we encourage the members of our church, to create rhythms in their lives, regular rhythms where you're engaging in relationships with people that don't know the Lord. And so that's really that kind of just outlines that in brief. And then of course, the bottom is a little card that you can use just as a reminder. So we looked at it last week, to be steadfast in your prayers, steadfast in praying for people that don't know the Lord, to be, as the word we used last week, to be a priest, to intercede on behalf of others, that God would do a work in their life. So that is a great tool. Kind of related to that tool, if you have not gotten this, we published this about a year ago. We call it the Covenant Wheel. And so there are nine sort of rhythms of the Christian life that we talk about often here at Christ Covenant. One of those is personal evangelism. And we've written little field guides, short little field guides that kind of explain each of these rhythms, everything from spending time with the Lord on a daily basis, we call that personal devotion, to gathering community, kind of why that's important, what that's like. And of course, one of those is on personal devotion. And again, all of this book has all of these, and you know, they're each about three or four pages, and they're great little field guides to get started. Who would be helped by this? Who's like, man, I would like one of those? Okay, ready? All right. And then if you want one of those, they're free. So you can just go right back to the emphasis table, and those are free. You can pick one. Now this one you have to pay money for, but we gave this one out last week. It's a really great book. It's called Making Faith Magnetic. And basically it walks through, you know, if you're in an office, if you're in a neighborhood and you're saying, okay, how do I make gospel connections? How do I kind of figure out what are people talking about, and how do I talk about those things in a Christ-centered, gospel-centered kind of way? Who could use some help with that? Who's like, okay, I saw your hand. I'm going to get a runner. Will you be my runner? Okay, awesome. Right over there. Okay, awesome. The next resource, that's also available at the emphasis table. It's called Making Faith Magnetic by Daniel Strange, if you just want to use the Amazon. And then the last one that we have, and I'm very excited about this, it's called Table Talk at Armor. This is for those of you who you have a friend, you have a family member, you've been praying for them, you want them to come to faith, but you just kind of need a little help in the conversation. I mean, it just, how do I kind of turn this toward gospel things? It's a great event to bring them to. Now your ticket to the event is to come with someone that's not a believer. So it's not just kind of all come, but it is, there's two nights of this, April 25, May 2nd. And this is, it's just a helpful time where we sit down with a bunch of Christians and skeptics and talk about different things that people are talking about. I just saw Billy. What are the two topics that we're covering? Where's Billy? There he is.
Happiness and death.
Death? Okay. Happiness and death are the two lectures. So everyone thinks about that, right? Everybody wants to be happy, right? So here's the invitation. You can say, hey, I want to talk to you know, you want to come to this thing, it's an event where we're just kind of gathering and talking about happiness from different perspectives. People will come to that. And then the next one, we're going to talk about death, you know. Everybody thinks about death. And so what happens to us when we die? I mean, that's an interesting point to begin the conversation. So mark your calendars for that and be thinking of who the Lord may want you to bring. Colossians 4, verse 2 through 6. Of course, the Apostle Paul is writing these things under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. And what that means is that even though he was writing this in a letter to this ancient church at Colossae, by the power of the Holy Spirit, these words come to us today in this present church, in this current church in Atlanta, Georgia, with God's authority, with God's power. And so let's hear together the word of God from Colossians 4, 2 through 6. Continue steadfastly in prayer, being watchful in it with thanksgiving. At the same time, pray also for us that God may open a door for the word to declare the mystery of Christ, on account of which I'm in prison. Pray that I may make it clear, which is how I ought to speak. Walk in wisdom toward outsiders, making the best use of time. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how you ought to answer each person. This is the word of the Lord. Well, as I mentioned, we're in this series on evangelism. Two things that I believe this text has for us today. Number one, you see it's right out of the text, wisdom toward outsiders, walking with wisdom toward outsiders. And then the second thing is gracious and salty speech. So let's look at those. Wisdom toward outsiders. I think a lot of Christians think about their Christian life like this, or they think about the church like this. You know, I go to church. Sometimes I'm in church, sometimes I'm not in church, right? And we also think that my responsibility as a Christian, if I really want to be evangelistic, is to go to church, give money to the church, and invite my friends to church, right? That's kind of the way that I'm carrying out the work of the church. Now, one of the reasons that we think that way is because of people like me, because of pastors. We've kind of said that to y'all. We've said, look, here's your job. If you guys will come, give, bring your friends, we'll take care of the rest, right? Leave the evangelism to us. We're the professional Christians. And again, I've heard pastors literally say a variation of that same thing. Look, you guys just bring your friends and come and we'll evangelize them. We'll point to Jesus. Now, of course, there is something sacred and beautiful about the gathered church where Christ is on display. And so if you're a non-Christian here today, I hope that's what you're seeing, the gathered saints worshiping the Lord. But what that does is it undersells what God has called for each of you, what God desires for each of you. It actually fails to understand what the church actually is. When you look at the New Testament, this idea of ecclesia, the church is more a people than it is a gathering, right? The church is those, the literal word means those who've been called out by the gospel. Now, as Christians, we do gather, which is incredibly important. What's happening right now? What I don't want you to take away from this sermon is that I would anyway undersell the gathering of the saints. What's happening now is incredibly important. But the church doesn't just gather. The church also scatters. You know, a lot of times, here's the vernacular that we should quit saying. You don't ever leave church, right? I went to church and I left church. Really, you don't leave church or go to church. You gather or you scatter, right? The people of God, right now we are a gathered church, which is a beautiful thing, and we need the gathering. In about an hour, we won't leave church. We'll just become the scattered church. We'll just scatter. We'll scatter with intentionality. We'll scatter on mission for the Lord. They're both important. We need the gathering because in order to represent Jesus, in order to be an evangelist, right, in order to be an ambassador for Christ, We have to know Christ. We have to be in fellowship with Christ. We have to live as if we are Christians. And this is Paul's whole argument. I mean, if you were with us last week, the beginning of chapter 3, he starts off with identity. I mean, he's like, you have died. You have been raised with Christ. You are seated with Christ in the heavenly places. Live into that identity. And that is why when we as Christians, you know, fall into sin, when we live in patterns of sin that is not representative of our Lord Jesus, it's so damaging. It's so damaging to the witness of the church. I mean, I would go so far as to say this. The witness of the church has been much more damaged by Christians not living faithfully to Jesus than it has by Christians not having enough evangelistic tools. Right? Now, both are important, and evangelistic tools are important. We're going to look at, I think, something that will help you here in just a little bit. But I want to begin here, right? I want to begin with actually what's happening here at the gathering. If you're going to scatter well, you've got to gather well. You know, we need to come underneath the preaching of God's word. We need to, you know, sing the word of God. Those things shape our hearts. They bring conviction. They bring about repentance. They bring about greater faith. This is how we live the Christian life. You know, in Colossians 3, I mentioned last week that that's where Paul begins this argument that we're here in Colossians 4. I don't have time to go through all of Colossians 3, but look at what he talks about here, and this is 3:5. He's talking about the result of being a Christian, the result of living into this identity. He says, put to death what is earthly in you. Put to death sexual immorality. Right? If you're sexually immoral, if you're not honoring God with your sex, you can't represent Christ. Put to death impurity. Put to death evil desire. That's why we need the gathered church. Our desires are being shaped. I'm not saying that any of us are free from evil desire. But as we more and more see the beauty and the fullness of Christ, our desires are shaped. Put to death covetousness. Right? We can't represent Jesus if we're coveting all the time. And that's a great threat in a city like Atlanta, a city of great material wealth. It's easy to become very covetous, where that's all you think about. That's going to make me happy. I got to be like that. Rather than resting in this identity that you have in the Lord, you've died with Christ, you've been raised with Christ, you're seated with Christ. What do you need to covet? If you really saw yourself as a child of God that is going to receive the inheritance of God, that would be like Jeff Bezos' child coveting John Kellis's, my child's inheritance, you know. You know, any of our covetousness would be silly if we really saw what we already have in the Lord. He says, this is idolatry, right? You're looking to another God. He says, on account of these, the wrath of God is coming. And you once walked in these when you were living in them, but now you put them all away. We must put them all away. And then he talks about a lot of relational components. You know, one of the things that ruins our faithful witness to the Lord is our anger, right? How are you going to represent Jesus if you are the person who's known by your anger? Wrath, malice. How are you going to represent Jesus if you are known as the malicious person? Slander, right? How are you going to represent Jesus if you're known as untrustworthy? Obscene talk. Don't you see here? We need the gathered church because who we are as a people, let me say it this way. It's pointless for us to talk about evangelism. It's pointless for us to talk about speaking for Christ if we're not living for Christ, right? It's pointless for us to talk about representing Christ if we don't know Christ, if we're not living in fellowship with Christ. And he goes on to say, don't lie to one another. And then he says, we put off the old self with its practices, and we put on the new self, which is being renewed in the knowledge of the image of its creator. That's the goal here. And I think it was Barnhouse. I read this in a commentary one time on Ephesians chapter 5, and I think it was Barnhouse that said, the highest calling ever that has been given is Ephesians 5:1, which says, be an imitator of God. That's the highest, like, That's the highest calling that anybody could be called to, and that's exactly who you were called to in Christ. Imitate God. Be like God. And so we need this. We need the gathering. We need our small groups. We need accountability groups. You know, also in Ephesians 5, this is from the old KJV. Ephesians 5 is a very parallel passage to Ephesians 5 and 6, and Colossians 3 and 4 have a lot of similarities. And one of the things that Paul says in Ephesians 5, he says, live, this is the old KJV, he says, live circumspectly. I think that's actually a good word. Live circumspectly. We don't want to use that word anymore. It comes from the Latin circumspectus, right? So circum is like a circle. Spectus, it's like spectacles or inspection, right? Live circumspectus. Live being known, right? Live being known in all parts of your body, right? It's easy to put on a good front, but what about the back? It's saying live circumspectly. Live being inspected at all sides. And again, this is a gift. Some of y'all may be like, oh my gosh, is this one of those churches that like wants to get to know me? And I just want to say, yes, it's a gift to be known. It's a gift to have your blind spots exposed. Live circumspectly. You know, don't be a hypocrite. Don't be disingenuous. It's easy to put on a good front. Anybody can do that. But if we're really going to represent Jesus, we have to be like Jesus, the whole circle, right? Not just the front. So as a church, we scatter, but we also gather, and the gathering is very important. And if we gather well, then we can scatter well. And when we scatter, again, you don't leave church, right? So you say, well, what time is he going to get us out of here if I can do the math? I don't know exactly what time, less than an hour, okay. When you leave, you're not leaving. You're scattering. You're scattering to represent Jesus. And you scatter with kingdom purpose, with missional purpose. We scatter so that through us, the glory of God can be seen and known. So that through us, God can begin doing this work of restoring the world to himself. I love the way Paul says it in 2 Corinthians 5:20. He says, God himself making his appeal through us. Isn't that a powerful idea? God himself making his appeal through you. You're not just an aunt. You're your niece's appeal for God. You're not just, an attorney. You go to an office and the clients you represent and the people that you work with, you're appealing to God on their behalf. You're not just a neighbor, right? You're an ambassador. You're making an appeal to the people in your neighborhood on behalf of God. You're not just a father or a teacher or a plumber or a volunteer baseball coach. No, God is making his appeal through you. And so we have to live circumspectly. We have to, if we're going to walk in wisdom toward outsiders, we have to be wise. We have to be holy and be pure. And we also have to, and I think that this is incredibly important, we also must consider the outsider. And I think this is a big part of this here. We must consider the outsider, the people that we've been called to reach, the people that we've been called to minister to. If you were with us last week, we gave you these little cards. And I really said, who are you called to priest, right? Who are you called to be their priest? And I hope that you filled these out, and I hope that you've been praying, and I hope that you've been interceding on behalf of these people. And I don't know who you wrote down, and I this is the power of the scattered church, is that you actually can know these people. And not every person is the same. There's a bit of diagnosis, right, that has to happen if we're really going to represent Jesus faithfully. Not every one of your friends is the same, right? This is one of the limits of the strategy of invite your friends to church. I'm not saying that invite your friend to church is bad for all people, but the church is limited. I can't know... I can't preach, 800 different sermons in this room right now. But you can know the particularities of each person. There's a sense where in all of this, we're having to do the work of contextualization, right? That's walking in wisdom with outsiders. We're contextualizing. Now, if you say, what does that mean? Some people will critique this idea of gospel contextualization or contextualizing the gospel. But contextualizing the gospel is not being less faithful to the gospel. It's being more faithful to the gospel. It's not presenting less of the gospel. It's presenting the gospel in a way that people can understand, right? And so if you were called to go minister the gospel in a different language, your first step is to do what? Go learn that language, right? If you're saying, well, I'm being really faithful to the gospel in English, these people just don't know English. They're saying, no, you're not. You're not being faithful to the gospel. You have to bring the gospel to bear. And we don't just do this with language. We do this in all sorts of things. Here's a little quote real quick. But gospel contextualization is not and cannot be presenting less of the gospel. It's presenting the gospel in such a way that the hearer can understand. Contextualization is bringing more of the gospel to bear, not less. And Jesus is always doing this. You know, when Jesus meets with Nicodemus, this proud religious leader, what did he say to him? Think about this. He said, you must be born again. Now, that's interesting. How humbling must that have been? I mean, here's Nicodemus, this great man, this powerful man, this respected man. And what does Jesus say to him? You got to become like a baby. But that's what he needed to hear. What he was resting in is his righteousness, his ability. But then, next chapter, Jesus goes and meets with a Samaritan woman. The next chapter, and what does he say to her? He doesn't say you need to be born again. She's already humbled. She's ashamed. She's been married 5 times. She's going in the heat of the day to go and get water at the well because she can't handle the rebuke of the other women in the community. And what does he say to her? He says, I'm living water. He gives her a word of hope. He's not less faithful to the gospel. He contextualizes the gospel. He understands who he's talking to. He diagnoses the person. Living wisely, living in wisdom toward outsiders, it is both living in purity, living in holiness, living as a believer so that you can represent Jesus, but it is also living in a diagnostic way to those that you're called to be their priest, to those that you're called to be an ambassador. Let's go to the second part of the sermon here, the second point. Which I'm calling gracious and salty speech. So walk in wisdom toward outsiders, verse 5. Let me roll down here. Making the best use of time. And then we read this, and I love this illustration here. Let your speech be gracious, seasoned with salt, so that you know how you ought to answer each person. This is what I'm talking about. There's a different answer that you give to different people. Just like there's different seasoning, right? You know, you can oversalt something. You can undersalt something, right? You have to know the meat. You have to know what you're trying to salt. You have to know what you're cooking in order to season it rightly. That's the illustration that Paul is giving here. You have to know how to graciously season your conversations with salt. And this can be the tricky part of evangelism. You say, okay, Jason, well, I'm willing to pray for people, and I'm even willing to ask people questions. Where I struggle with evangelism is when I have to speak, right? When I have to say something. Well, I want to help you with that a little bit. When I grew up, there was a lot of different methodologies, but the world is so complex now. It's so pluralistic. There's so many different types of people that you're going to run into. But I think what's most helpful, when you just think through, and this is, I use this, when I think through, how am I communicating my faith to this person? There's kind of this fourfold, or these four pillars of a gospel presentation. Of God, man, Jesus, and response, right? In order for somebody to become a Christian, they have to have some concept of God. They have to have a biblical concept of God. They have to have a right understanding of themselves, humanity, or sinfulness before God, our need for salvation in Jesus, and then, of course, we respond. So let's walk through this a little bit. We'll start with God. And again, you have to ask some diagnostic questions. You're trying to reach your family member or neighbor. Do they believe in God, right? If they do believe in God, what God do they believe in? Is it the God of the Bible? Is it another God? Do they think they believe in the God of the Bible, but actually how they believe in God is not how God represents himself in Scripture, right? That's an important diagnostic question. And then why do they have this particular viewpoint, right? Were they raised in a certain way? Are they reacting against something? I mean, a lot of my friends, I have a lot of people that don't believe in God, or they say they wouldn't believe in God, but you know, they maybe grew up believing in God, and they're reacting. And most of their not belief in God is a reaction to bad experiences they had, hypocrisy in the church. That's very different. That's a very different person than people that grew up with no concept of God in their home, right? It's very different than a person who grew up in like a Jewish or a Muslim household, right? So again, the way that I talk to them about God, the way that I think about entering into that conversation is different, you know, based upon who I'm talking about. You know, again, I love the New Testament language of ambassador. What does an ambassador do? An ambassador is a citizen of one country that goes to another country. They go to a totally different context. And what do? They represent their country. They work for the good of their home country and for the good of the country that they're representing. And different ambassadors have to do different things. I mean, and this is the way we live our lives. So, like, let's say you were the ambassador to Israel. And then let's say that you were the ambassador to Saudi Arabia, right? You're both representing the United States, right? You're both representing the same home country. But the context, the culture, the language, the story that is informing this person versus this person is incredibly different, right? I think that's so important for us. We have to understand, okay, I'm an ambassador for the Lord. Who is God sending me to? I have to get to know them. What's informing them? What's shaping the way that they think about the Lord? This is really a diagnosis, right? And again, I love the illustration of graciously seasoning with salt, right? If you take the lid off the salt thing and just dump it on, it's not going to be good. You got to know how and when to apply the salt. But as conversations go, of course, what do we believe as Christians? That there is only one God, that he is the creator of the whole universe, that he is the only redeemer of the universe, the only hope for redemption, that he is all-powerful, that he rules, that there's no one that can challenge him. He's not threatened by some other God. He's a three-person God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, like we just sang, who exists in holiness and in love. There's more to be said there, but I want to keep moving. The second, of course, gospel anchor is man, humanity. So if you're trying to talk to somebody, how do they view themselves? What is their understanding of their own soul? You know, it's interesting as we get into a world that is more and more and more secular. Actually, a lot of my gospel conversations, they're not God, man, Jesus response. They're like man, God, man, Jesus response. People may not have a concept of God, but they do have a concept of themselves. They do have some concept of themselves, and they, of course, understand their own frailty. They understand their neediness. They understand a sense of longing that may exist in their soul. Sometimes it's best to start there. You know, every human soul, I believe what Augustine said, "My soul is restless until it rests in you, O God." I believe every human soul is in that condition. It's restless. And so when you talk to the people, you can tap into the restlessness, the longing in their heart. Yeah, Albert Camus has this great quote in his book, The Fall. He says, "Because I longed for eternal life, I went to bed with harlots and drank for nights on end." Isn't that an interesting quote? Because I longed for eternal life. Because I had this like insatiable desire, I went to bed with harlots. I drank for nights on end. But then he says, "But in the morning, to be sure, my mouth was filled with the bitter taste of the moral state." That's why we're talking about death in the table talk. Everybody faces this. Everybody faces their own mortality. And some of y'all are so young, you're like, "I never think about my mortality." You will as you get older. This may be a better evangelistic tactic for 40 and up, you know. But we all think about our own mortality. We all think that we have some purpose in me. Our souls long for something because I long for eternal life. I went to bed with harlots and drank for nights on end. Of course, as Christians, we believe that the reason that our souls long for this, the reason that our souls have this sense of longing about them is that we know we're separated from God. Because of our sin, we've broken fellowship with God. And of course, what we read in Scripture is that God is just. Now, on one side, you've heard me say this before, that's a comforting thought. God will bring justice to all injustices. But on the other side, that's a terrifying thought. It's comforting when we've been the victim of injustice. It's terrifying if we are the perpetrator of injustice. Now, usually when people begin to have this concept of their own sinfulness, of their own fallenness, you know what they usually do? They try to go do something moral. You know what? They put together a righteousness resume, is what I like to say. They put together some resume and say, well, look what I've done, right? Look, I've been to Sunday school. I've been to church. I walked the old lady across the street. How could God be mad at me? I know I've got some mistakes there, but look at all this good stuff I've done. The problem is, you know, a resume is something that you control. Some of you guys are employers, and what do you do when you hire somebody? They have an impressive resume, but then you hire them, and you're like, they're not that impressive. And so you start keeping a file, and you take note of all their stuff to do, all the good stuff that they've done, and all the bad stuff they didn't do. Well, that's what God knows. We don't get to prepare a resume. No, he knows us. He's got our file. He knows more than we know. He knows us to our depths. You know, he knows us that even in our most righteous things, even in the moments where we're most praised by men, there's still clouds of sin in our heart. You know, Ray Ortland, who's going to preach here in a few weeks, has this great little quote where he says, if sin was the color blue, even my most saintly prayer has a few drops of blue in it. And Ortland's right. He just said that to me in conversation, but I've never forgotten it. And he's right. And God knows this, that even in our greatest righteousness, there's pride, there's self-centeredness. The point is we have this disease that infects us that we know about. It creates this longing. We can't save ourselves from it. We desperately need a Savior. And of course, this is the good news of the gospel. If people understand that there is a God, if people understand their human condition, then the message of Jesus is incredible. The message of Jesus is incredibly restorative and powerful. And this is the thing about Jesus. You know, every other religion will tell you how to self-improve, right? Islam, here's the five things you need to do to become a righteous person. You know, or it'll you know, Buddhism, here's how you reach nirvana. Here's what you need to do to self-improve. Even secularism, right? You know what the Bible of kind of secular humanism is? You know what the Bible of secular humanism is? It's self-help books, right? Self-help books. Here's seven steps to losing weight. Here's five steps to making more. We're trying to maximize ourselves because that's where salvation is found. Again, I'm not saying that you shouldn't, you know, go on Atkins diet or whatever you do, but like, what I am saying is these books don't talk about this as if it's a little help. It's salvific. This will make you whole. This will make you the person you've always wanted to be. And we do these and we get exhausted. And we say, I need to go buy another self-help book. That's the problem of secular humanism. It only reinforces your own depravity. Right? But they all have the same thing. They all say, here's how you fix yourself. But Christianity is unique. Jesus is the only religious leader that doesn't point to something external. Jesus doesn't say, go do this law, go do this thing. You know what he says? He says, come to me. Look to me. I am the way. I am the truth. I am the life. I am the river. I am living water. I am the bread. What religious leader has the audacity to speak that way? And the answer is only one who is, in fact, God. I love what Al Mohler, this is a little quote from Al Mohler. He says, if all we needed was enlightenment, the Buddha will do. If all we need is a collection of gods for every occasion and need and hope, then Hinduism will do. If all we need is a tribal deity, then any tribal deity will do. If all we need is a lawgiver, Moses will do. If all we need is a set of rules and a way of devotion, right? Muhammad or Joseph Smith will do. If all we need is inspiration and insight into the sovereign self, for crying out loud, Oprah will do. But if we need a savior, Only Jesus will do. And of course, the incredible message of the gospel, this is where all of us are. We've all sinned against God, and we deserve to be separated from him. We deserve to come under his judgment. But Jesus, who knew no sin, you know, who only ever lived in purity and wholeness with God, Jesus, who never sinned, for our sake, was willing to be punished. He endured the punishment for our sin on the cross so that we, through him, could receive his life, reward, peace, unity with God. This is the incredible message of the gospel. And this is why that quote I read last week from Tim Keller, he said, the church is not the result of planning or development. The Christian church was the fallout of an explosion of joy. If you've tasted this, if you've recognized your own depravity and your own fallenness before a holy God, if you've recognized that God in his mercy for you sent Jesus, a Savior, to die in your place, to be punished in your place, to give you righteousness, to bring you back into fellowship with God, if you've tasted that, then the response is an explosion of joy. And so you won't be thinking, man, I don't want to mess up the social fabric of my office place and say something about Jesus. You can't help but say something about Jesus. It's good news. It's good news. You realize this is good news for me, and this is good news for the whole world, which is exactly what the gospel is. And of course, this leads to the final step. We have to respond. We respond to the gospel. When we're sharing our faith, we call people, what are you going to do with this? And of course, the Christian response, and if you're like here today and you're saying, hey, how do I become a Christian? Here's what it is. Okay, this is the Christian response. It's very simple. It's repent and believe. Turn from your sin and trust in Jesus. Turn to Jesus. That is the message. And that's the amazing message about Christianity. You know, the story I always like to tell, if you've come to First Sunday, I've told this story. But it's, you know, it's Luke 15, the story of the prodigal son. You know, here's the prodigal son. This is a picture of saving faith. Here's the prodigal son. He was so proud, wasn't he? He was so self-righteous. And at the same time, he was so fallen. He was so debaucherous, you know. But what was he doing? What was in the heart of the prodigal son? He was like Camus, right? Because I wanted eternal life. I slept with harlots and drank for nights on end. And that's exactly what he did. He went to his father. He said, I can manage my money better than you can. Give me my money. And he went off. And in my mind, he tried to go make $1 million, but had a bunch of failed investments. And he lived in wild living, and he blew it all. And there he is, naked, ashamed, ruined. It says he came to himself. He realized the depth of his sin. He came to himself. He had that moment of clarity. And what does he do? And this is really what repentance and faith looks like. He says, I'm going to go to my Father, and I'm going to say, Father, I have sinned against heaven, and I have sinned against you. And he asks, of course, his Father to receive him back as a servant. That's really saving faith. When you realize, I have blown it against God, I've sinned against God, yet the only one that can save me is God. Do you believe, I mean, think about this. Do you believe that the very one that you've sinned against, who should judge you, is the only one who actually has reached out the offer of salvation who can save you? That's what saving faith is to turn to the one that you've most offended. And if you trust that God in his mercy loves you like that, and he sent Jesus to you to save you. And of course, what happens when the son goes back? I can imagine the scene. He's walking back to the father, so ashamed, so terrified of what the father might do. And what does the father do? As soon as he sees him, the father's out there looking for him. He runs to him. And he takes his naked boy and he holds him in his arms and he throws his best coat on him. He puts a ring on his finger. And he kills the calf and he celebrates. This son who was dead is now alive. And he throws a feast and he receives him back as a son. And here's the thing, if you repent of your sin, if you turn to the Lord, because of what Christ has done for you. That is the offer. That is the good news of salvation. How are you going to respond to that? And if you're not a believer, I invite you to think about that. Will you respond? If you are a believer, if you've tasted that, then the only right response to that is an explosion of joy, where we go out and we say, look what God has done. Look who our Father is. You know, when I talk about what it means to be a pastor, I always give this illustration. Do we have it working on the screen? I always give this illustration. You might say, well, is that what being a pastor looks like? But I always give this illustration, and here's what the illustration is of. It's of a shepherd. It's as of a sheep pasture. That's what the big box is. And the shepherd, you know, is here in the middle of the sheep pasture, calling the sheep in. Hey, this is the good grass, right? This is the good grass. This is where joy is. This is where life is. This is where you're most connected with God. Come in. Come into the good grass. Come in and have fellowship with God. Come in and live in holiness and obedience, right? That's what I want to do. That's what I'm trying to do right now. Come on, guys. Come in. Come into the pasture. Come into the green grass that your Father has given you. Don't run out here. Don't go running outside the pasture. Don't go run after the other things. But all you're doing out there, and this is what I'm trying to do as a pastor. This is why you run. It's what Camus said. Because I long for eternal life, I slept with harlots and drank for nights on end. Now, you may not be sleeping with harlots or drinking for nights on end. Maybe you're just proud. You don't want to humble yourself before God. You want self-independence. Maybe it's wealth that's grabbed your imagination and your heart. That's what's going to make me happy. Maybe it's notoriety. That's what's going to make me happy. I don't know what it is. Maybe you're with, you know, a boyfriend or girlfriend that you should not be with because you think this is going to make me happy. Because I longed for eternal life, I worked and never Sabbathed. Because I longed for eternal life, I dated this person I shouldn't have been dating. Because I longed for eternal life, I kept all my money to myself and was never generous, don't you see? And what my job as a pastor and what I tell our pastors is, look, what we're trying to do is say, they're actually longing for something. They're longing for something good. They're just going after the wrong thing. And so we redirect them. This is what you're looking for. What you're really looking for is fellowship with God. We redirect these wandering sheep. And that's the same thing that you're called to. That's the same thing that all of us as Christians are called to. To say, no, come here. This is where the good grass is. This is where fellowship with God really is. And so we're going to respond to this today by participating in believer's baptism. And I think it's the best, such an appropriate response to this. Because we're going to see, this is a person who's seen this. He's tasted it. Who's seen the beauty of what it means to come alive in the Lord. And I would invite you as we worship, as we sing, as we respond to these things, I'm going to be standing in the back. I would love the opportunity to talk to you, to pray with you. Maybe there's somebody in here right now. And you're like, what does it mean to respond? Repentance and faith. Tell me what that means. I want to do that. Come and find me. Maybe there's just a friend that you want to pray with. Come and find me. Let's stand together. I want to pray for us, and we'll respond as we sing. Father, help us to see these things. Help us to know these things. I thank you for the gathering today, Lord. We need it. As we prepare to scatter well, may Christ be exalted in our hearts. May we come into the good pasture. May we be filled with fellowship with you, O God, in your Son, Jesus. And it's in his name I pray. Amen.
That the Lord outstretched arm have led us to salvation, from slavery to blessing, from famine to his feast, to
this morning, Brianna is going to come and share her testimony and what the Lord has done as we celebrate her and this baptism moment. We got all our kids here. It's amazing. We're so glad that you are all here. Let's listen. Brianna, tell us what the Lord has done in your life.
Hey, everyone. I'm Bree. I'm super excited to be up here and sharing my testimony today. So I was raised Catholic for half my childhood and then started going to a non-denominational church in high school. And I went to Sunday services and religion classes as a kid, but if I had been asked what it meant to have a relationship with God, I would have had no answer. I didn't know that there was a personal relationship to have with him. I never opened my Bible outside of church, and I thought that going to church on Sundays was all that religion was, honestly. And I consider myself to be Christian, but I wasn't living a Christian-led life. I found my identity in everything except God. And I tried to rely on myself and control everything until my senior year of college when I rediscovered what that meant. So at this point, I hadn't been going to church throughout college, and I didn't have my parents waking me up on Sundays. And at this time, God placed an amazing community of Christians in my life during my senior year. And they spoke so boldly about their faith that it made me start rediscovering it for myself. God sprouted that seed that he had planted as a kid. And I remember going back to church, and I would get so emotional, and I would tear up. And I didn't know what the change in spirit going through me was. And so I went home, I pulled out my Bible, and I started reading. And I got plugged into a life group and discipleship with a small group leader, and it changed my life, honestly. I learned what it meant to rely on him and to relinquish control. And I went from only thinking about God on Sunday mornings to reading scripture daily and seeing his hand and guidance throughout the day to day. He changed my heart and took on my sins. And I'm so grateful to be here and share my testimony and accept him as my Lord and Savior this morning. Amen.
You know, you got your mom and dad here. Come on up, y'all. That was, I mean, you finished college in like 3 years, so like that. So that was only about a year ago?
A year and a half.
I think one of the neatest things when the Lord draws you to himself and he saves you, because you needed a savior. And when he met you and saved you, that desire he gave you for the word, the way he speaks to you through that. And you have this community of believers, the gathered church. It's an amazing journey that the Lord has for you on this side of salvation. And so it's a privilege to get to baptize you based on your profession of faith, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. We're buried with Jesus in baptism unto death, raised to walk in a brand new life. I think mom and dad did y'all drive from North Carolina? Is that right? Came from North Carolina to visit with us today. This is just a sweet moment. So you know what? Come and visit with the Walkers over here after the service. And kids, it was so great to have you in here. You can head back to your classes for just a few more minutes. To have the kids here and get to hear these testimonies, these profession of faith, it's just a beautiful thing, and it's fun, and it's rowdy, and it's awesome. Something I never got to do as a kid, going to church, to get to witness this up close. We are so grateful that the Lord has been at work in this place, the gathered church, and now we get to go be the scattered church, bearing witness to the hope that we have. And we do it with gentleness and respect, hoping that the Lord will save people just like he saved us. And so it's in his power and in his hope that we leave this place, knowing that we still are united in spirit. There's many ways to get involved. Again, check out your bulletin. A lot of things coming up in the church. You can help us continue the ministry of the gospel financially. There's several different ways to be a part of giving to this local body, and we're just grateful that you're here. If you have questions, come see us in the lobby. Jason will be at the Connect desk right out here. He'd love to visit with you. I'll be out there. A few of our other pastors will be out there. We'd love to just have that time to say hello and get to know you a little bit. Our tradition, every time we do one of these baptisms, is to sing the doxology together to close. So would you stand as we sing to the Lord to close out?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly.
peace. Thank you.
Them want to belong.